Lord be with you.
Also with you.
So good to be with all of you today, this 12th Sunday after Pentecost. And it is also Vicar David Small's last Sunday. He is preaching his farewell sermon. It's hard to believe that a year ago, 50 weeks to be exact, Vicar Small left or arrived, and today he's leaving. And sometimes they come and they go, and you get really close to these young men, and it can be like an emotional roller coaster. But we are so grateful to you, Dave, for your service. We're thankful to our Lord that we brought you here, and pray that you have learned a lot from us as well as you prepare for this office of holy ministry. Towards the end of the service, in fact, just prior to the benediction, there is a special liturgical part of the service. It's a farewell and Godspeed service for Vicar Small. Also, the new vicar will be arriving. Next Sunday, we're vicarless. So I'm on my own, but then Monday, the next day, the new vicar and his family arrive. Vicar Devin Murphy, his wife Melissa, 3-year-old daughter Penny, and 1-year-old son Devin Jr. And then we'll be installing him 2 weeks from today in this 11 o'clock service. Vicar, you've got a great message for us today, but you're here. Anything you want to say, final announcements?
No final announcements.
You'll save it for the sermon. Amen. Amen to that. All right. Well, so regarding the vicar that'll be here in 2 weeks, there's a red box in the narthex. We do this for all of our vicars. If you, just to put it on your hearts, if you'd like to bring a welcome card, maybe a gift card to Publix or to Winn-Dixie, something like that. We used to fill a grocery cart. Remember those days? And the grocery cart was to overflowing, but the problem is we had like 10 bottles of ketchup and 5 bottles of pickles and stuff they could never go through in a year. So the gift card seems to work a little bit better because then they can buy what they really need and fill up their pantry. It's just a wonderful little way to welcome the new vicar. But today we bid farewell and Godspeed to David. We're honored to have your mom and dad here. Barbara, and your dad was here a minute ago, Scott. He's here, there he is, he's coming in. So thank you for your son and for letting him join us and do ministry among us for the past year. Let's stand, let's share the peace of the Lord with one another. God's peace be with you.
Thank you. Amen.
We would kneel as we are able for confession. Worry reveals that we are sinful to the core by nature, and that we cannot free ourselves from it. By things done and left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We confess our sins to you, Lord. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us. So that by faith we will join Abel, Enoch, Noah, Abraham, and Sarah in blessing the world with your mercy. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
We stand and sing.
This is what the ancients were commended for.
By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what is visible. By faith, Abel offered God a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as a righteous man when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, he still speaks, even though he is dead. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, Abraham, even though he was past age, and Sarah herself was barren, was enabled to become a father because he considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, and he as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and as countless as the sand on the seashore. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. And they admitted that they were aliens and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 12th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, or about your body, what you will wear. Life is more than food, and the body more than clothes. Consider the ravens. They do not sow or reap. They have no storeroom or barn, yet God feeds them. And how much more valuable you are than birds. Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? Since you cannot do this very little thing, why do you worry about the rest? Consider how the lilies grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you, not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today, tomorrow is thrown into the fire, how much more will he clothe you? Oh, you of little faith! And do not set your heart in what you will eat or drink. Do not worry about it. For the pagan world runs after all such things, and your Father knows that you need them. But seek his kingdom, and these things will be given to you as well. Do not be afraid, little flock. For your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for yourselves that will not wear out, a treasure in heaven that will not be exhausted, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let us now join together and confess our holy Christian faith to one another in the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Almost
boggles my mind just how many places I've lived and how many moves I have made. And for each of those moves, I was always excited about the opportunity to come. I was always looking forward to something, and I knew that God had a plan for me there. But this time, it's a little bit different. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm excited to go back to St. Louis to see my friends again. We will talk about our Vicarage experiences and discuss where we went right, the successes we had, some of the challenges that we faced, and we will learn from each other. But this move is a little bit different because each of those previous moves, I was ready to move on. I was done with wherever I was living, and I wanted to focus on what was coming next. But this time, I don't really want to move. I find myself thinking that there's still more for me here. Even though I know God has great things planned for me for the next nine plus months of my life in St. Louis, and that while I'm at the seminary for my fourth year, He will build me up, and He will bring me to be the person and the pastor He needs me to be for His people. And I can stand here today and say that I trust Him with wherever I will go, but this is still a difficult move because You have welcomed me, and I want to thank You for that. I want to thank You for welcoming me here, for being patient and gracious, and for teaching me throughout the last year. I pray that I've been able to teach you and to help you and to make an impact on your lives just as you made an impact on mine. You know, but as sad as this parting will be, I truly believe and I know that God has great plans for all of us, and that His great plans for us are beyond whatever we can imagine for ourselves. If only we would have trust in Him to fulfill His plans. And so this morning I would like to share with you a little bit about my faith journey in the hopes that it would help and build up your faith. And I think the words that God has been speaking to me to pass along to you are these words from Genesis chapter 15. You can find that on page 13 of your Bibles if you wish to follow along. Genesis chapter 15, beginning at verse 1, reads, "Do not be afraid. I am your shield." I can only imagine how comforting that must have been for Abram. And especially to hear that from the Lord. Because how often would we wish for anybody to say that? But here, Abraham's hearing it from God Himself with His own ears. And what is a shield? If you think about that, a shield is something that protects us, that defends us. And it keeps you steady when you're about to tip over. But God also promises Abraham something else. A reward. This reward is not for his obedience. This reward is not because Abraham did everything God asked. This reward is because God loves Abraham. This reward is God's to give freely. It's God's to promise, and He does. And because this reward was promised, Abraham believed. And that was credited to him, his righteousness. And as I look forward to my next year, it's reassuring to me to know that God is also my shield, my protector, and that He will seek the best for me. But if we can put ourselves in Abraham's position right there, and God has just promised him a reward, but Abraham's thinking, and he says, "God, You also promised me a child, and that hasn't happened yet." So Abraham's wondering what God is doing. What good is a reward if the person who inherits it is not Abraham's child? That's what's going through his own mind. So God takes Abraham outside to show him the stars. And just imagine a world without light pollution. Imagine a world where a place, perhaps you've been camping and you can see the thousands upon thousands of stars. And when you think you can count them, then you lose track and you have to start all over. And God tells Abraham, this is what your descendants will be like. They will be as numerous as the stars. And as we read that today, I think we can also just think about how many stars are in all of the galaxies that we cannot see with the naked eye. It's pretty humbling that God would bestow his gifts and his promises on somebody to such a large degree. And because that was promised, Abraham believed. And he, because he believed, got the reward God had offered. This reward is righteousness. This reward is part of God's very own essence. This reward is beyond any earthly treasure or anything that you could ever pass on to your own child. And the reward didn't happen for Abraham just because he was a swell guy or because of anything he did. There were times where Abraham sinned, where he doubted God, where he even laughed at God's plan. And if I'm honest, I would say that I probably have laughed at God's plans too, once in a while. There might be some of you thinking the same thing. But God promises us his righteousness through faith because he loves us. Out of love that he sent his son to earth to be among us and to die on the cross for our sins. It's out of love that God the Father rose Christ from the dead to give us this hope of new life. And it's out of love that he gives us this new life through baptism. And that in baptism he promises us this reward of righteousness. And that he promises us that he will make us his children. And in a very real way, though, we actually receive Abraham's inheritance as his children. Now, God's promise of physical children for Abraham did come true through Isaac and Jacob and the people of Israel. That promise was fulfilled by God. But if we also look at this descendants of Abraham, we will also find the Messiah, Jesus himself. And we will also find in the ancestors of Jesus people who were not descendants of Abraham. We will find people like Ruth, who were accepted because of their faith. Not because of what she did, or not because of who she was born to, but because of her faith. And she made herself into the lineage of Jesus. And in a way, too, that she is a descendant of Abraham because of her faith. And we, too, are descendants of Abraham because of the faith that we have in God. And so we share in Abraham's inheritance and his reward, and God is also our shield, our protector, and our reward. Abraham, he has an amazing story. One that I think is very pertinent to my life in some ways, because God told Abraham to get up and go. He told Abraham to leave his father's house and to go to the land where I will show you. Abraham didn't know where he would end up, but he had faith. And he had faith not because he went where God was telling him, but he had faith and God showed him where to go. And moving on from here, I think I will face a similarly profound faith in my life. I know that God is my shield. And unlike other shields that we can fashion for ourselves, God will never break, and He will never bend. Now, that doesn't mean that nothing bad will ever happen to me or to you. But it does mean that God is always there. And that when the devil attacks us, God is there to protect us and to defend us. Over the last year, I'm actually very amazed at how much my faith has grown. Not because I had so much of it before, but because I didn't expect to learn about that. But you have taught me, and God has taught me. And one of the best prayers that I believe any Christian can utter is, Lord, please give me more faith. And this is something that He has worked in me. And I believe that this is something He is working here at Bethlehem too. He has blessed my time here. So I've learned so much from you. And I've learned so much from Pastor Baronis this last year. You are truly blessed to have him as your pastor. And God has strengthened my faith to know that wherever I go and whatever I will be called to do, that He is with me. That He is my shield. And the same is true for you, you congregation of Bethlehem. Because as you move on with your ministries here at Jacksonville Beach, there will be times where leaps of faith will be required of you. There will be times where your faith and your path is challenged. There will be times where my faith is challenged. And sometimes we will be unsure about where God wants us to be or how He will use us in a particular situation. There will be times where we're unsure about the costs of following Him or doing His will. And there will be times where we won't really know what's going to happen next. We can't see that far into the future. But faith gives us the ability to know that our shield and our Lord goes before us, clearing our path and leading our way. And as our great reward, God has already given us more than we could ever imagine. He has given us His Son. He has given us forgiveness. And He has given us a new life. This life is meant to be lived for Him, but it's also meant to be shared with others. And this is one area where we might need a leap of faith, where I might need a leap of faith sometimes too. But I'm also reminded of what God tells Joshua in Joshua chapter 1. Joshua was the leader of the Israelites after Moses. Moses who led them out of Egypt. And how do you follow that? But Joshua was in charge of leading the people into the promised land, and he was responsible for feeding them and caring and protecting them. And although he had been trained, he was an assistant of Moses, although he had been trained, I can't imagine just how nervous and anxious he would have been. So as a final exhortation to be the commander God needs him to be, the Lord tells Joshua, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened and do not be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." This comforts me, and I hope it comforts you as well. Our Lord will remain with you here in Jacksonville Beach, just as He will go with me to St. Louis. And even though I truthfully don't know where I will be 1 year from now, I know that wherever I am, God will be there with me as well, to be my shield and my strength. So thank you for allowing me to become part of your community. Thank you for all you have done for me. I will continue to keep you in my prayers. It's my most sincere prayer that Bethlehem. and remains in faith, and that others, especially those who don't yet know Christ, will know Christ through you. Now may the Lord keep you from all evil and keep you in his promises for life. May the Lord watch over your comings and your goings, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Here in time and hereafter in eternity. Merciful God and Father, you have raised up children of Abraham from all the nations through faith in your word and promise. So bless your church on earth by the seed of Father Abraham, our Lord Jesus Christ, that your people would be defended against the assaults and temptations of the adversary. By your Holy Spirit, grant them to live unto righteousness in Christ and to shine like the stars in heaven forever and ever. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, Heavenly Father, you open your hand to feed the ravens and to adorn the lilies of the field. And how much more do you satisfy the wants and needs of our body and life in this world? Order our days and our deeds in your peace, and grant us the wisdom to live within our callings in the godly fear of your name, being neither anxious nor afraid of any foe on earth, but with steady confidence in your gracious providence. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God Almighty, the consolation of the sorrowful and the strength of the weak, rescue us and all your people from all harm and danger. Take away disease, ward off famine, set free those in bondage, and grant health to the sick and the distressed. Especially today, Lord, we pray for Kim and Ed Bartow, for Mike Culbertson, Tom Warwick, Monica Tack, Barbara Hilbrecht. Today, Lord, we pray a prayer of thanksgiving for your healing for Robin Buckner, who was in intensive care on life support for 3 weeks, and today joined with your people here in worship. We pray, Lord, a prayer of praise and thanksgiving to you as the great and glorious physician, and pray that that same healing would be for all of those for whom we pray today, including Alan Werner, Julie Truex, Diane and Martin Johnson, Richard Campanaro, Newton Elmore, Catherine Helton, Vicki Junk, Janet Wiegman, Howard Estervig, Mary Jo Hunneby, and Jeannie Roman. We pray, Lord, that you would deliver all those who call upon your name, that in all their necessities they may rejoice in your manifold help and comfort. Lord, in your mercy,
amen.
Lord God, gracious Father, we thank you for all the blessings you have bestowed on us through your servant, Vicar David Small. By your word and spirit, we pray that you would continue to preserve his faith and that you would grant him readiness to grow in wisdom, knowledge, and skill for all those he serves in your name. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
us, most merciful Father, and these are humble requests which we offer unto you in the name and for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever, and who teaches us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Give thanks. Thank you.
Christ, strengthen and preserve you in both body and soul, now and until life everlasting. Amen. Let us return thanks. We thank you, Almighty Lord, that you provide even for the birds of the air and the lilies of the field. How much more do you provide for us, your dear children? You give us this holy communion, Christ present for us in forgiveness in the midst of the worry and anxiety of our lives. We thank you, adore you, and praise you now and forever. In Jesus' name, amen. Congregation may be seated, and Vicar David, if you would please join us right here. Beloved in the Lord, Vicar David Small is going back to the seminary to finish his studies and prepare for the office of the Holy Ministry. At this time of farewell and Godspeed, let us hear the word of the Lord. From Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 through 8. I thank my God of all my remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making my prayer with joy, because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to feel this way about you all, because I hold you in my heart. For you are all partakers with me of grace, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness how I yearn for you all with the affection of Christ Jesus. And from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. This time I'd like to invite any elders that are here present to please come forward. We're laying on of hands as we wish David a farewell and Godspeed, and pray God's blessing upon him.
Towards you and give you his peace.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.